Very good morning, everyone. Hope you're all doing great. Welcome to the doubt and revision session of your financial management. Now, we've done through the entire content. We've done lots and lots of question practice from your workbook as well as your practice and revision kit of PPP. And with nearly, you know, the exam now around the corner, I'm sure that each one of you are now prepared towards your exam. But today's session is extremely important. Why? Because I want to familiarize you all with an actual mock exam on the actual, I mean, near to actual platform from ACCA, which is the CBE practice platform. Now, before I actually begin, I want to get a rough insight into as to where you are in your studies, where you are in your preparation towards your June 21 is your FM exam. Now, quickly, please, I want everybody to give me an answer in the chat box if you guys are familiar with the functionality of the CBE practice platform. Are you familiar with the functionality? Have you gone through what it looks like? Have you tried to attempt a mock exam on it? So apart from what we did in the class, have you already tried? That's wonderful. What about others? I need to know where, what is your status? Only then, you know, I will be able to advise you that what more needs to be done. Okay. Okay, fair enough. Okay. No worries. So I'll start with the very basic as to how you guys can actually access your CBE practice platform. So you just go on to Google, type in your ACCA Global. Once we go on to ACCA Global, you go under the student section. So here is what you need to go on to. Go on to study support resources. You select the ACCA qualification. You select your paper, which is financial management. And now you have all of these resources available to you from the ACCA. All of these resources are extremely important. See, we've done the base work as of now. We've done that. How do we need to prepare ourselves for the exams in terms of, you know, going through the content, going through the exam practice, the question practice. But now is the revision phase. So very, very important is that we know what we need to do and how we need to do. So we are actually here. We are now on to the effective learning and the revision phase. Basically, you need to go through each one of these technical articles. You need to go through an examiner's report to get into an insight of, to, you know, what the examiner feels that this is where most of the students actually lose out on marks. Once we actually know, we can read the psyche of the examiner. We understand what the examiner, you know, awards marks for, what the examiner deducts marks for. We obviously will be then learning from other people's mistakes. So that is something which is extremely effective. That is something which is extremely important as well. So we don't want to make the same mistakes which others have been making. Rather, we would learn from their mistakes and improvise upon it ourselves as well so that we are able to pass the FM paper. So very important is to go through this examiner's report. Exam technique, I mean, how much, you know, how much do I really lay stress on it, because it's extremely important. Now you've got all of these resources available to you. You've got many past exam library question papers. You could look at some of the FAQs which students generally have, and definitely this is something which you're already familiar with in terms of the formulas, the tables which will be available to you. Now, before I actually dig deep, let's quickly have a look at the pass rate for your financial management paper. So pass rates are less than 50%. So really not very encouraging numbers. So now you have to really, really gear up yourself. You really have to come in the fifth gear now to know that, you know, this is what I need to do to be able to pass my paper. And I have to be in the average, say 45% of the students who are passing the paper once they actually attempt it. So make sure that you are amongst the percentage of people who are passing the paper. And that will only come when you're actually listening to what I'm saying, you are following what I'm saying, at least from today up to right up till your exam day. So I'm sure you must have been doing this ever since, you know, we started with the classes. You must have done each and every question from your practice and revision kit. Very important to note here is that financial management is not just only numbers. You will be asked good amount of theory questions as well. So please do not ignore theory part of your financial management. I will show you a mock exam today, a full-fledged exam of how it looks like. So you will become familiar in terms of, you know, that, okay, this is what gets tested and this is the kind of weightage which is given to theory as well. So let's very quickly start. I'll come back to all of this. So I was just going to familiarize you how to access your ACCA CBE practice platform. So this is just the link which you need to click. There comes your access for, so log into the practice platform. So you just click on here, put in your username and password, and that's it. That's all the, you know, you need to, you will be able to shoot your practice platform. I'm just gonna now refer to my own one. The thing here is that for most of the papers, we have been able to assign mock exam, but unfortunately for financial management, it is presently not available on VG Learning's platform because of some technical error at ACCA's end. But nonetheless, the same set of questions are already available to you via the practice platform, which I had just shown to you. So you, instead of going through these steps, which I'm now showing you, you just go on to here, click your log on to practice platform, shoot your ACCA platform. So this is exactly where you would be. So I'm just gonna come over to your financial management paper now. So this is exactly the same set of resources which are available to you via your own My ACCA account. Just log on to it with the steps I've just shown you. So I'm just gonna go through a past exam. Okay, so let's just assign ourselves a practice test. Okay, so this is financial management practice test 2. Okay, so what I really want you to have a look at is how the question is going to look like. So let me just unassign it to myself again. Oops, what have I done? Why did I log out of it? Just bear with me. Let me log back in. Okay, so financial management, official resources. Bear with me, please. Okay, so ACCA resources, past exams. I just want to show you how the exam is going to start like. So I just want to, like, you know, start from the very beginning itself. Okay, so let me just show you one more question. Something that has a start button to it. Okay, there you are. So this is how your exam is going to start with an introduction page. Now, extremely important that you all should be familiar with the modalities of your CBE exam before actually, you know, going for the live exam, before actually sitting down at home to, you know, in front of your invigilator and trying to, you know, go through these very basic introduction and, you know, the functionality of the practice platforms. So this is something that we're going to be familiar with before we actually sit for the exam itself, so we know what to expect in the exam. So we all know that the sample questions are going to be constructed response questions that, you know, they will be asked in the live exam as well. So this practice exam is reflective of the constructed response section of the live exam, but has some differences. So before I actually log on, I just want to highlight that, okay, this replicates the actual exam, but obviously there are certain, you know, major, minor differences that are there in the actual CBE, you know, platform and the CBE practice platform. Obviously, this exam is not going to be timed. Your real life exam is going to be timed. Once you've started this exam, you are able to leave it by closing the browser window. However, in the actual exam, you obviously cannot, you know, just leave your exam in the middle of it. You have to finish all of your exam. You have to click on the end exam to be able to review your, you know, to be able to submit your paper. So this is also something which is obviously because it's a practice, you know, it's a simulation, it's a practice platform. So this is something which is like slightly different from the actual exam. In the live exam, your answers to the constructed response questions will be expert marked. Here, obviously, you can either self-assess yourself or you can submit me your mock exam. I'll be more than happy to get back to you with your, with your responses. Now, because of paucity of time, I really, really want, today is what, 22nd, right? So I really, really want you all to submit me, you know, a mock exam to me by the 25th maximum. So this is something which is extremely important so that I also get time to check each one of your answer scripts and submit back to you with constructive responses. So this is something which is extremely important. You will be able to access the solution material at the end of the exam by using the self-marking resources, which will obviously include a marking guide as well as sample answers. So this is again something that you can be looking out for. So once you've done an actual mock exam under, you know, a timed scenario, what you could do is you could self-mark yourself as well. You could review the sample marking guide, review the sample answers, compare it to your answers, so you know what are the areas of improvisation which is required. If you wish to access these without completing the questions, you obviously can just end the exam on the item review screen and navigate to the marking tab on the dashboard to self-mark itself. So this is just like introducing the practice platform to you. This functionality, which we've like just done here, would not be there on your real exam, because this is just to familiarize you that, you know, what is it that the practice platform is similar and different to from the actual exam. So now this instruction sheet, 4 pages of instruction sheet are going to be absolutely same in your real exam as well. So very, very important that you go through each one of these instructions before the exam only. You should all be well familiar with what to expect in the exam, the look and feel of the exam, the instructions that you need to follow. Please do not wait for any last minute surprises that, oh, this was it, I didn't even know it. So that kind of a scenario we don't want to put ourselves into. So general instructions, in this exam, the instruction screen will obviously not be timed, but your actual exam is going to be. So this instruction sheet is going to be available for a maximum of 10 minutes prior to the exam. In the live exam, once your 10 minutes are over, your real exam is going to quickly, and you know, it's going to just start automatically, which obviously doesn't happen in the practice platform. A copy of the instruction screens can be accessed at any time during the exam by selecting the help button. So you could actually come back to any of these, you know, instructions if you want to do while giving your exam, but obviously we don't want to be, you know, in such a situation that we really don't even know what to expect in the exam. Okay, so how do I answer and how do I navigate? You obviously, bare minimum that you need to read each and every question very, very carefully. There is the question number we are viewing is displayed on the top display bar. You can hide or restore this display by selecting this button, which is going to be there. You can navigate between windows by selecting this previous and next window. Just look down to where my cursor is, this previous and next window. So you can come to the next, you can go on to the next window. You could navigate back to the previous window by using these navigation buttons, right? A warning message will display to remind you that you cannot navigate away from a question if you have not viewed all the question content. So now, how is that? Let me just show it to you. See, this is the, this is the reminder, or you can say alert, which is going to pop up because it says I've got some unseen content. So you have not viewed the entire screen. Please use all the score bars and or open any on-screen exhibits before trying again. So the exam, the exam is trying to support you by telling you that, hello, do not move on to the next screen because you literally have not read this entire screen as yet. So we do okay. We go down because there was more to the page which we had, tried to skip. So that is why that error message was there. So there was a warning message displaying. So again, that is something which is going to help you. Some questions have a scenario and answer area divided by either or a horizontal or vertical splitter bar. How that happens, I'm just going to show that to you. You can move the splitter bar to move to see more or less of the scenario or answer the answer areas. Please ensure you provide an answer for all elements of each question. Obviously, you must answer each and every requirement of every question. You can revisit questions and change your answers at any time during the exam. The beauty of putting your answers on a computer, right? You literally don't have to cross out your entire page. If you feel that there's something that you want to just edit, you can just go back to the answer. Obviously, use your backspace, your delete button, and just revise, edit whatsoever you want to do it. So that definitely saves on a lot of time and energy. And not to mention the fact that your answers look perfect, right? Because you literally, there's just going to be no scribbling like a paper and a pen exam is usually like. So there is also a flag for review option. If you wish to revisit a question later in the exam, you can obviously put down a flag option, which will show to you as flag at the end of the question, at the end of the paper as well. So you can always go back to these flag questions. Very important functionality. Remember, time is the essence, right? So now for any exam, for any, particular requirement, if you feel that you're skipping on time, you're actually dedicated more time than what is required, just flag your question for review, leave it, drop dead the question. We'll come back to it later after having attempted the entire remaining question paper if we still have time. So this is something which is extremely important functionality. Click the button again if you no longer wish to revisit or review the question later in the exam. So you can flag and unflag your question anytime. Any questions? Anything anybody wants to ask? If anybody has any queries, please feel free to ask there and there itself. I'll be more than happy to repeat it. This is something which is extremely important. No, as much as your theoretical knowledge is required, your content knowledge is required. Very important is to develop the right exam skill as well. And that is precisely why I'm running through you an entire CBE mock exam so that you know what to expect in the exam. So please feel free to drop in your queries at any time. Okay, instruction 2 or 4. Help button, you could click on the help button provided to access, which would give you the list of your formulas, which would give you the list of the tables. Remember your discount tables, your annuity tables, we will always require them during our exam, right? So this is where you're gonna get them. There is a help oblique formula sheet, which is given to you in the exam. Where it is, I'll show it to you in the exam itself. There is a calculator, inbuilt calculator as well, which is given to you, which is already there in the exam. So now very important for you to understand that you can all make use of this calculator. You can also carry your own calculator. So your scientific calculators are allowed in your FM remote exam as well. Very, very important to note here, because like for myself, if I talk about myself, I am, comfortable using my own physical calculators rather than making use of the on-screen calculators. Even though the functionality is there, now you can decide for yourself you know you can use this on-screen functionality of calculator, or ACCA allows you to use your own scientific calculators as well, as long as it doesn't have the functionality to store, that is, memory function should not be there. Any regular scientific or regular calculator is allowed in your ACCA exam. Note that the exam also allows you to bring calculators. So again, which are something that I've just mentioned here. Now the platform itself is gonna have functionality like the highlight, the strike through functionality. You want to highlight in different colors, questions that are pertinent, you know, the information, the question which is pertaining to your one particular requirement of the question, you can always use it. Anything that you feel is something which is probably not required for you to come back to, you can use the strike through functionality for it. Workings or a scratch pad. So you may use an on-screen scratch pad to make the working notes. Now, very, very important information here, because your June 21 exam is going to be a remote exam. This scratch pad functionality is what you have to make use of, which is given in the in the platform itself, in your system itself. You cannot make use of any physical rough paper or scrap paper, as we call it, something that was allowed, you know, while you were conducting your exams at center. But because the exam is going to be remotely invigilated exam in June 21, in order to maintain the rigor of the exam, a physical rough paper at your end is not going to be allowed. You all only have to use the scratch pad functionality to make all your workings for your FM exam. I hope I have made this clear to everyone. I hope there is absolutely no confusion regarding it. Muskan wants to ask, ma'am, there are some questions in part A and B which are very calculative and needs to make table and many working notes in order to get answer. How do we solve them without Excel? Don't worry, Muskan, that's precisely why I'm here today. I will tell you how to solve these questions. So A, you can either make use of the scratch pad functionality which is there, which obviously is like a paper, right? It is not going to do any mathematical calculations for you. So you can only note down like we note down on paper, right? But ultimately we make use of our calculators to solve it, right? So either you make use of the scratch pad functionality, or there is one more option which I will show to you when we actually start the exam, right? So just hold on to your question for then, and I will answer your question, Muskan. Meanwhile, is everybody familiar with the fact that there is going to be no physical rough paper or scratch pad available or allowed to you during your remotely invigilated exam? You will be required to make use of the scratch pad given in the platform itself, right? Is that okay with everyone? I need your confirmations, please, because this is very important. Students, you know, sometimes do not understand, and, you know, at the end of the day, it just leads to a lot of panicking on the day of the exam because you don't know what to do and how to solve your questions without the rough paper. And I absolutely do not want any surprises for my students. Wonderful. Okay. So if the notes entered into the scratch pad are not going to be marked, it's your rough paper, the examiner will not even be able to open up your scratch pad, right? So anything that you're putting on the scratch pad is not going to be looked at by the examiner. One word of caution here. So anything that you want the examiner to actually look at, any working that you want the examiner to actually look at, especially I'm talking for section C questions, because obviously section A and B will not require any workings to be displayed. Any workings for your section C questions, which you want the examiner to look at, do not do them on the scratch, but do them on the Excel, on the answer itself, right? Because that is the only script which the examiner is going to mark. So nothing on the scratch pad is going to be evaluated, is going to be marked. So anything that you want the examiner to look at must be done on the main face of the answer itself, right? So if you want the marker to see any notes or workings for questions in the constructed response section of the live exam, you must show them within the answer areas which are there. So very, very important first part here itself. Okay, wonderful. So let's proceed. Instructions 3 or 4, copy paste functionality is available. Your control C, control V functionality that we use to copy paste in your Microsoft Office is going to be allowed on this platform itself. So anything that you want to copy paste from the scenario is something that you can easily do on your answer sheets as well. So just use control C, control V and you will be able to copy paste. How to do that? I will show you to you when we actually start the exam. Symbol button is available for you to put down any currency symbols required. So just click on the symbol button and put down whatsoever currency you want to put down for. Navigation screen can be accessed at any time by just selecting the navigator button, which looks like this. So I can actually jump onto questions. Supposingly from first question, I want to move on to the 10th question. I can just go on to the navigator button and switch questions very, very quickly. It also will highlight the status of your question. So anything which is complete, which is not complete, will be again, just will be navigated and can be flagged for review for a later point of time as well. Now you can choose close each window, which is you've opened individually, because you can definitely open up multiple windows in one go as well. Before we actually, end the exam, very, very important for everyone is to review the exam. So you can review your exam once you've attempted any or all of the questions. To do this, just navigate to the last question, click on next. It will automatically take you to the review screen, which is going to be there. Now, item review screen, it will very, very quickly just show us what is the status of our questions. Have we attempted the question? Was it flagged for review? Is the question complete? Do we need to go back to any particular question? It will just quickly give you a glimpse of your entire question paper. How does that look like? I will show it to you as well. Now, once you've navigated the review screen button, we then are literally done with our exam. So this is the time we can actually end our exam. Remember, in the actual exam, once you've clicked on this end exam, you obviously will not be able to ever revisit your exam again because you've ended it. So please be 100% sure that you've revised, you've done everything that you wanted to do in your exam before we actually click on the end button. And obviously, if time runs out, then this is something which happens from the back end itself automatically. Select next to move on to the exam summary screen. So this is how your exam for FM is going to look like. You will be presented with 2 constructed response questions. Remember your section B questions, each of which is going to be 20 marks in total. 40 marks is going to be two in total. All questions are compulsory questions which you have to attempt. In the live exam, you obviously need to make sure that any workings in the constructed response questions must be done in the question in the answer script itself rather than going to the scratch pad for it. So this is how the exam is going to look like. Okay, did I not click the entire screen? Okay, now I have. So that is how it gives the warning. So now it is again prompting us that, in the exam after 10 minutes, this is something which is going to automatically happen. But because we are here in the simulated environment today, it is asking us that, okay, are you literally ready to enter or launch your exam? So yes, we are. So we're going to just quickly click on yes. So this is how your exam is going to look like. So the question is going to be there. Your answers are going to be put down here. Now, what I really want to do is just very quickly go through an entire modulated exam with you. So let me just open up. What have I done? Let me just open up the platform again. We'll start with section A questions to begin with, so that I show you how do you have to enter your answers, how you will be attempting your questions, scratch pad, calculators, everything. Okay. Where is my FM? FM. FM past papers. Let's start with our questions. So this is how your section A is going to look like. You'll just have to bear with me for a second. I forgot to bring my water. So let me just very quickly fetch water for a second, please. Okay, so let's start with our section A questions. So section A, we all know we're going to get 15 objective test questions of 2 marks each, making it a total of 30 marks towards your section A questions. So wonderful. Let's click on next. So this is how it is going to look like. You will be having your options to insert symbols if required. You could highlight, you could choose the color in which you want to highlight your answers. You could make use of the strike through functionality. You could open up your calculator to make your calculations. This calculator here, you can obviously scroll it, put it wherever you want to. It could be a scientific mode, or you could shift it to a standard mode as well. You know, just look at what you are more comfortable in using. Just cross it out. And this is your scratch pad. So this is literally your rough paper towards your exam. You can scribble, you can put down anything that you want to put in it. This scratch pad will not be viewed by the examiner. This is just a replacement of your physical rough papers that there are. You can put down information, you can, you know, just put down whatsoever you want to put down on your scratch pad. So supposedly I'm showing you like a copy paste functionality. So I just want to put down a control C, control V here is something which is there. So you can copy paste information from the question as well. You could literally, you know, just put down whatsoever numbers you want to put down. So I want to do like 980 divided by 45 is what we need to do to solve our question. But remember, this is only a paper. This is not going to put down or solve the question, unlike an Excel for you, right? So this is something that is not available to you, that, you know, something you have to hop onto your calculators to do this yourself. But this is something which you can definitely make use of in order to solve your questions. Now, this is one thing which is there. If I open up the scratch pad again, it will automatically keep on saving whatsoever I have done till date. So whatsoever you do, it keeps on getting saved by the system itself, right? Unless you obviously delete it. So if I delete it, this is something which will not show up. And this is something which is there in your answer sheet as well. And then very important is your formula sheet here. So the list of instructions that we've just read are given in your instruction sheet. Your formula sheet is here. So this is what we need to use. So we know that, okay, these are some of the formulas which will be given to us in our FM exam. So if I need to refer back to these formulas, I can always jump onto this. So this is my present value tables, my discount tables, followed by my annuity table. So this is just exactly where you need to jump on to when we need to refer to this table, right? Everybody okay with it? So there's a scrolling button here wherein I can just move on to left or right. I can increase the size of anything that I want to. And so this is what basically it's gonna look like. And now I think we are ready to start solving the questions, right? So we'll be quickly to solving all the questions and simultaneously taking up all the exam technique which would be required here. So quickly, I want you to now start telling me the answers. Whenever there is going to be questions that requires calculation, we'll do that also. Can you open help table and scratch pad simultaneously? Yes, of course you can. So you open up your scratch pad. There you are. Your scratch pad is open. You can navigate your, you know, windows left and right. You can open up your formula sheet and you can again navigate it left and right. Right? This is how you can set it wherever you are comfortable with on your screen so that you can navigate multiple windows simultaneously as well. Right, Sakshi? Sakshi, I hope I have answered your query. Wonderful. So let's quickly have answers towards your question A. First question. So D says everyone. So which of the following is an advantage of implementing just-in-time inventory management? Absolutely right. That it allows us that the amount of the obsolete inventory will be minimized here. So yes, indeed, this is the right option. So this is how you choose the right option by clicking on it. And then we just move on to the next question because this was something that just required us to submit the right answer, right? So very quickly, quickly, I want you to answer this question as well. So now remember, the question is asking you to put down two of the following activities. So please just put down two activities, right? So select two activities because the examiner has clearly asked you to do two, right? Okay. So which of the following activities are carried out by financial intermediaries? Definitely financial intermediaries help in transforming maturity as well as help in transforming risk. So I would go in with option C and D. Rightly identified by Anshu. Muskan, is that okay? They help in transforming your maturity as well as in you being able to handle your risk, right? Wonderful. Next question then. Okay, so this is something that is going to require some calculation at your end. So very quickly, what you require to do is read on to the question, open up your scratch pad here. I'm just going to open up my scratch pad and start doing with my whatsoever I need to do in this question. Keep your calculators handy, or if not, you could make use of the calculators given here as well. So you can literally open up multiple screens. You could resize each one of these screens as well, depending upon, you know, how I want to look at my answers, how am I scribbling. All of this is something which is possible. Very quickly, answers please. The whole purpose of today's class is to familiarize each one of you as to how to solve questions on the day of the exam. 9.8 says Jatin, I hope you are using the functionality of the platform itself, like a scratch paper, or are you still on your Excel or your paper for that matter? So please, today, okay, because you're, you know, you're just learning how to do it, this is fine, but everybody has to do mock exams on the practice platform. You must get a look and feel as to, you know, how am I going to practically do it on the day of the exam? Let's make our own life easy. You do not want any surprises on the day of the exam. So put, you know, actions, you're just viewing it today, right? So I want everybody to do it themselves as well so that you know exactly how to be able to solve it as well. So very quickly, Frost Company is planning 1-for-4 rights issue with an issue price at a 10% discount to the current share price. The EPS is currently 0.50 and the shares of Frost Company are trading at a price earning ratio of 20 times. The market capitalization of the company is 50 million. You have to tell the theoretical X rights price, the TERP, which is required. So what do? Can we quickly just solve it? So we have, what is the current share price? The EPS is 50 cents. And the shares are on a price earning ratio of 20 times. Okay, so the current share price . Even if I actually don't scribble all of this, because it's only a rough paper and I only need to, you know, just put down my final answer. You can literally skip with trying to beautify your answer. Multiply with 20, quickly do this, because see, you don't actually, the scratch part is not going to solve it for you, right? So you have to make use of your calculators. So either I open up my calculator like this and do my 0.5 multiply with 20 equals to 10. So I've got this as 10. So I'm either making use of this calculator here in whatsoever mode I want to, or you could literally, you know, I personally feel it's much, much faster doing it on your physical calculator. So just make use of that. And I have the share price. Then what is going to be the PERP? So presently, what is the rights issue price? Rights issue is being given at a discount of 10%, right? So, okay, rights issue price is, I'm just putting down everything here. You need not do that in your exam. Literally, what you need to do is just quickly solve it for yourself, right? So, I'm going to put down 10 into 90%. So, see, I mean, personally, I feel it's a little pain in the neck to make use of this scientific calculator here. I would rather just make use of my own calculator. So I have, so it is being offered at the price of 9. So what is happening? It is 1 for 4, right? So you've got 4 shares. At a price of 10. So that gives you 40 price. And then you've got what? 1 share at a price of 9. So that makes it equals to 9. So you've got 5 shares at a price of 49. So what would be the price per share? The TERP is going to be 49 divided by 5. That comes out to be 9.8, right? Is everybody okay with it? Everybody understands how to use it? Everybody's given me the answer 9.8. So that's just wonderful. Great going, everyone. Now, this is one way of solving a question. Now, let me very quickly show you one more way which you can literally make use of. Now remember, this is literally like making use of a paper, and this is not solving anything for you, right? So what you could also make use of is go onto the navigator button, and I just quickly navigate myself to section C question here. As soon as I come to a section C question, I have an Excel available on me. So what I'm going to very quickly do here is, I, instead of, you know, making use of my scratch pad, making use of my calculator, trying to waste so much time, I can very smartly just make use of my 4 shares at 10 equals to 4 multiplied by 10. 1 share at 9. That's equals to 1 multiplied by 9. So that's equals to 5 multiplied by, all my Excel functionality is available here, is equals to 49 divided by 5. Voila, I have my answer. Now, remember, this is actually your section C, workspace. even though I've used it like a rough paper, I literally cannot keep my workings here. So when I'm actually doing it, I've got my answer. I'm going to quickly delete all of it, go back to my navigator, go back to my sections, my question, because it's going to keep on prompting me its own smartness as well. I'm back on my question. I'm putting in my answer and I'm quickly going to the next question as well. Okay, 9.8. See the, okay, let me just show it to you again. So what just happened here was that I just put on my answer as 9.8. But what does the examiner want us to do? The examiner wants us to put down the answers to two decimal places instead. So what I should do is put down my answer as 9.80. And thank you for, you know, the system which was able to tell me that, hello, I was missing out on putting down my two decimal places as required by the question itself. And then I can very quickly move on to the navigator, the next question. Now, is everybody okay with it? Do you all understand? I'm giving you an option. Remember, this is something which is not, you know, something that, you know, probably that you 100% should do. It is only an option which I'm giving to you just because I personally feel that solving questions on Excel saves a lot of time, energy, effort from the student's angle rather than scribbling things on the scratch paper and then, you know, making use of the calculators. So we can be smart. We can just very quickly go onto the navigator button because this is something which helps us navigate. Very quickly, we move on to section C, come to this one, have your Excel opened up, scribble your information here. Remember, you must always, always delete it at the end of your paper because this is something which you don't want the examiner to see because this is definitely not answer to this particular question, right? This is something that we've just used as a temporary rough paper for ourselves. Is everybody okay with it? Does everybody understand the modalities of using your section C response sheet as a help towards your answering your towards section A and section B questions? But always, always remember, this is something that is not the correct answer for this particular question. So this must, all of these, whatever you're using as a scratch pad, as a rough paper, must be deleted before you actually submit your answer because this is something which the examiner can see, right? And this, whatever scribbling we've done is obviously not for this particular question here, right? Does everybody understand this? So again, I'm giving you a word of caution here. It's entirely your choice whether you want to do it like this or not, or you are happy to use the scratch pad functionality. I've just given you a way out because personally, many students come back to me and say that, you know, they are not very, you can say, comfortable using this, you know, system scratch pad. Is there any other way out? So this is the only practical way out which you can make use of. Obviously, there are going to be pros and cons attached to it, but you have to be very, very careful and decide for yourself as to how you want to answer your questions. Right? Is that okay with everyone? Okay. So we move on to the navigator button again. Now, remember, there's one more word of caution which I want to give you here. Because we've opened up this question 31, the navigator button marks it as complete, even though we literally have not done this question, right? We've literally just opened up the workspace to be able to solve it for, you know, to be able to use the Excel workspace or the, you know, constructed workspace, which is available to us. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to flag it for review so that I know that this question is something that I still need to come back to. Right? Everybody okay with it? So let's move back to our next question, question number 4. Okay, so very quickly, I want the answers then. Quick answers, please. False. So you have to literally answer every requirement, right? So each one of these statements, you have to tell me whether it's a false or a true. So very quickly. False, false, true, true, says Kush. False, false, true, true, says Jatin. Okay, so let's start. The price earnings, the earnings yield method and the dividend growth model should give similar values for a company. No, that's false. This is how you select an option. You just move on your cursor and press on it. It will start showing a different color. So that's a false. Market capitalization represents the maximum value of a company. No, not really. That's a false again. Price earnings ratio is the reciprocal of earnings yield. Yes, it is. PE ratio should be increased if the value be if the company being valued is riskier than the valuing company. So the PE ratio is going to be, it's going to decrease, right? If it is more riskier business, so this PE ratio is going to fall, right? So it's false, false, true, false, everyone. Right? Is everybody okay with it? Okay. So very quickly. So there you are. You've been given some drop-down question. You need to select which is the right answer here. Funding gap indeed is the right answer. Well done, everyone. So small and medium enterprises have restricted access to capital markets. The difference between the finance required to operate and what they are able to obtain is obviously the funding gap. So I just select the correct option, quickly move on next. Great, very quickly, the next question. Commercial paper says Muskan. What about others? So Max Company is a large multinational company which expects to have a 10 million cash deficit in 1 month's time. The deficit is expected to last no more than 2 months. Max Company wishes to resolve its short-term liquidity problems by making use of an appropriate instrument on the money market. So definitely the most appropriate to meet your short-term cash deficits would be a commercial paper. Your treasury bill, somebody said treasury bill, right? So treasury bill is a source of finance of the government, right? So this is something which you obviously cannot use. You cannot go and buy yourself a treasury bill, right? So that is a debt paper that you would be actually, that is, you know, a debt or a bond that you would be buying. And that is a source which the government uses to raise, you know, money for itself and not yourself. It's taking a loan, right? Right? Everybody agrees upon it. Commercial papers, that's great. Let's quickly move on to the next question then. Very quickly, you have to tell me which of the following statements is true. D says Muskan. Okay, what about others? So in relation to capital markets, which of the following statements is true? The return from investing in larger companies has been shown to be greater than the average return from all companies. No, that's not true. Weak firm efficiency rises when investors tend not to make rational investment decisions. No, under weak firm also, you know, everybody makes rational investment decisions. Weak simply means the kind of efficiency where that ticks in into the market. Allocative efficiency means that transaction costs are kept to a minimum. No, it doesn't mean that. It just simply means that, you know, you are able to respond to new information to the market likewise. Research has shown that over time share price appears to follow a random walk. Yes, so there is indeed a random walk theory. So that is the correct option. Right, everyone? Everybody okay with it? Okay, so very quickly, question available to you. So either you could make use of the scratch pad here or just work your way towards opening an Excel spreadsheet for yourself and answer. So you have to find yourself a 6 month forward rate. Remember, the rates of interest given here are per annum. So do not forget to convert that into a half year rate. Quickly, please. Answers. So you've been given country Y currency, country X currency, country Y interest rate, country X interest rate, country X expected inflation rate, spot exchange rate in country Y is 1.6 pesos per $1. You have to tell the current 6 month forward exchange rate in country Y. So very quickly, how do we do this? Remember, your home country will always be the denominator. So country Y interest rate is 1%. This is per year. We are looking for 6 months. So convert that into a half year. Your interest rate parity, country X interest rate is given to be 3%. So we're going to make use of these to find out our 6 month forward rate. So which is obviously your present spot rate multiply with your 1+ interest rate in your foreign country. 3% per year will mean 1.5% per annum here, divided by your base country, which is your home country, which is 1% per year, would mean 0.005, right? So this is how we calculate. Just very quickly make use of your calculators. Again, the information given here has to be done in what it is, in two decimal places. So my answer is 1.62 it is, right? 62 or 63, whatever it is, we're rounding off. You can just put down your answer. Right, everyone? So I'm just navigating to the next one then. Okay, very quickly. Very quickly do this question, please. So remember your Baumol's model. How do we know which one is home currency? Okay, let's go back to Ajit's question here. Remember, always dollar is your home currency is what we were told when we were doing our classes, that the dollar will be always assumed to be your home currency. And you need to find out your 6 months forward exchange rate in country Y, where the home currency is the dollar. Right? Right, Ajit? So you're finding it out for country Y. Country Y currency is the dollar. Ajit, is that okay with you? Tell me, please. Wonderful. I really, really need to quickly go through this. Okay, so let's very quickly go through the next question. So your share price at the start is given. You know your share price. Your share price at the start is given. Your share price at the end is given. You've been given your dividend growth. Why are you not highlighting? Okay. You know the share price at the end. You've been given that the total dividend paid is 15 per share. Can you just make your use of your Baumol model to quickly find out the total shareholder return? So let's just do that. What do we have? We have our latest, what is this total dividend given? So let's quickly find this out. Our share price at the beginning is at the end is 3 less your price at the onset, which is 2.5 plus your G. G is how much? Your total dividend given is 15, 0.15 divided by your base price, which is the price at the beginning, which is how much? Which is start is 2.50. So can you just very quickly solve this for me? So this comes out to be, we're trying to find out a percentage of it. So this is equals to 26% is what the class tells me. So I'm just making use of it, right? Is everybody able to do it? Quickly do it like this, or you could just move on to your section C, Excel, open up the, you know, the spreadsheet and solve it there. So whatsoever you're comfortable with, you can absolutely do. Both the options are available to you. As long as you get the correct option, that is the only thing that matters at the end of the day. Quickly question. Next question then, please. Cost of equity is what we need to find out. If in same question, if dividend is payable instead of actually paid, in that case, we calculate in the same manner. Yes, so depends upon what is given to you. Is it an ex dividend price or a cum dividend price, right? So that is what is going to define you, that you always need to take your ex dividend price, right, Jatin? So just reduce the amount of dividend if it is including dividend. Wonderful. Next question then, very quickly, please. So you're paying an annual dividend of 55% of the earnings. Its EPS is 80 cents and they've got 10 million shares in issue. The rate or the return on equity cap, the return on equity is 20%. Is 20% and its current cum dividend share price is 4.60. So very quickly, please do this. Your current cum dividend price is 4.60. Dividends, annual dividend of 55% of your 10 million shares is there, and your current EPS is 80. So can you just find out, let me just open up. So what is going to be your dividend to be paid? Dividend to be paid is going to be equals to what? How much? Your 80%, so 0.80. of your price, which is how much? Let me just refer it. 55% it is. So that comes out to be equals to how much? That is equals to 0.44 per share. 44% per share is the dividend to be paid. So that is going to be 44 cents per share is going to be the dividend to be paid. So what is the retention ratio really? So you've kept out of the total dividend, if you're going to pay off 44% or if you're going to pay off, what is the 55% of the earnings is annual dividend, right? So 55% is paid off as annual dividend. So your retention ratio is equals to 45%. Can you just make use of your formula to find out your growth? So dividend growth rate. Remember your retention, your B multiplied by R formula. So which is equals to going to be how much? Equals to going to be dividend growth rate is equals to your return on equity capital is 20% or 45% is going to be. So 20% of what 45% it is, right? So 45% is going to be the dividend which is going to be paid. The G which is there, which is obviously equals to, comes out to be equals to what? 9% it is, right? So how much is the dividend that is going to be paid? So what is the cost of equity? Cost of equity. Let's just quick, very quickly calculate. So that's 44 cents, 0.44. In your growth rate multiplied with 1 plus G, G is equals to what? 9% it is, right? 1 plus G divided by your cost of equity, which is equals to how much? Cost of your share price is, latest share price is 4.60, less your dividend, which is going to be there. So that is equals to 0.44. Can you just very quickly calculate your cost of equity? 20.5 is what Jatin says. Has everybody been able to get 20.5? Plus G is also going to be there. Has everybody been able to solve it? Is it 20.5? Shall I select 20.5? Quickly solve it on your calculators for me, please. Okay, great. So I'm selecting 20.5 and moving on to the next question. So instead of doing it like this, you could have gone up and opened up your Excel space as well, your workspace as well. Whatever you're more comfortable with, definitely something that you can be doing. Okay, so now we have to find out if Mille Company matches its working capital cycle with the industry, what will be the decrease in the net working capital? Okay, so we need to find out the net decrease in the net working capital. So very quickly, please look at this question. You've been given the options. Find out your answer and select the right option very, very quickly, please. Okay, everybody done it? Let's have the answers then. 624600 says Anshu. Okay, so the first is what you're saying. Okay, let me just very quickly go through it. So Mille Company is looking to change its working capital policy to match the rest of the industry. Following results are expected for the coming year. So you've been told revenue, cost of sales, gross profit. Revenue and cost of sales can be assumed to be spread evenly throughout the year. Working capital ratios compared with the industry are as follows. Receivable days, 50, industry, 42. 45 inventory days, 35 industry rate. Table days, 40 for Mille Company and 35 for industry. Assume there are 365 days in a year. So if you're now looking to convert to a working capital cycle with that of the industry, what will be the decrease in the net working capital? So very quickly solve this. So what is going to be impact on receivables? So they're going to come down from 50 days to 42 days. So let's just very quickly do this. Let me open up my Excel so that I can very quickly solve it for you as well. Okay. The only drawback here being that obviously the figures will not be shown to you, unlike your spreadsheet, which was there, right? So I particularly think that, you know, probably you could just make use, because you obviously cannot be looking at two questions in the same way. So let's quickly try and do this on the scratch pad only, because obviously you want to see the question as well, right? So let's quickly go back to it. Okay. Oops, previous question. Scratch pad. Okay, so what will be my reduced receivables? So what is my present level of receivables is going to be, it's going to reduce by 50 minus 42 is going to be 8 days, right? So what is the amount of receivables of 8 days? So that's 8/365. Multiply with your receivables amount, which is equals to revenue 20,500. That's going to be reduced receivables, your reduced inventory. From 35 to 45, it is going to come down. So that's 10 for 365 days. Inventory will always be calculated on your cost of sales. So 12,800. Thereafter, it's going to be your payables. Payables are again part of your inventory on cost of sales, right? So payables come down to what? 5. Payables, it's going to come down to 5, right? 365, multiply again with 12,800. So can you just solve this very quickly on your calculators and tell me the total amount of working capital reduced, which I believe, yes, is equals to 624,600. 624,600. Please make use of your calculators very quickly. Or you could make use of this calculator here as well. Again, you could switch between modes as well if you find this like more comfortable just to do a simple calculation. This is something that you can make use of as well, right? Everybody okay with the answer? A says everyone, so that's just wonderful. Let's move on to the next question then. Okay, very quickly, true or false is what you have to tell me. I think we've done through this. Can I move on to section B questions very quickly? Just, I want everybody to give me an answer for this. I have to wind up by 1 today maximum. Prospective merger would need to result in a company having share market share greater than 80%. Before it can be described as a monopoly. No, that's not true anywhere. Thereafter, a government may intervene to weaken its country's exchange rate in order to eliminate a balance of payment deficit. So yes, that is in fact true. A relatively high rate of domestic inflation will lead to strengthening currency. That's false. Government's fiscal policy involves the management of interest rates. That is false again. So false, true, false, rightly identified by Anshu and Kush as well. Well done. What about others? Is everybody okay with false, true, false, false as the sequence? Wonderful. Let's quickly move on. I really want to quickly come on to section B and section C questions. So very quickly, you have to tell me whether the following statements about interest rate risk hedging are true or incorrect. I'll just grab some water for myself till then. Quick answers, please. Interest rate floor can be used as can be used to hedge an expected increase in the interest rates. No, you cannot use an interest rate floor. That is just the bare minimum that you're looking in terms of your hedging. Cost of interest rate floor is higher than the cost of interest rate collar. That's right, because you're literally betting on the least price that is going to be there. The premium of an interest rate option is payable when it is exercised. No, the premium is paid at the date of the delivery. So not, you know, one, not when it is exercised, but at the date at which it is purchased itself. The standardized nature of interest rate future means that over and under hedging can be avoided. No, that's not true again. So false, true, false is what Anshu is saying. What about others in the class? Is everybody okay with it? False, true, false, false, or incorrect, correct, incorrect, incorrect. Wonderful. What about others in the class, please? Okay, so the next question, please explain the last option. Sure, let me come back to it, Sakshi. So the standardized nature of interest rate futures means that over and under hedging can be avoided. Can it be avoided? It's standardized, right? It's not flexible. It's available only in fixed whole numbers, right? So what is it that it leads to? It leads to over or under hedging of your securities. Right, Sakshi? Because it cannot be customized to your exact requirement. So somewhere in whole lots, you will be able to over or under hedge your risk. Point two, the cost of the interest rate floor is higher than the cost of the interest rate collar. This is something that you will just know by experience, that the cost involved on taking an interest rate floor is always going to be higher than that of a collar. There is no explanation to it. That is how it always is. Right, Jatin? So that will just come with experience. Okay, great. So let's quickly move on to the next question then. Very quickly. Can I have the answer? We all know that the agency problem means what? That the shareholder wealth is not being maximized. So yes, that is what the agency problem is, because the owners of the company are different from the people who are actually managing the company. So yes, that's right. And well done, everyone. Okay, quick question then. Last of the lot, I think it is. Then we'll quickly move on to section B questions. Quickly, so swap company is due to receive goods costing 2,500. The terms of trade state that payment must be received within 3 months. However, a discount of 1.5% will be given for payment within 1 month. Which of the following is the annual percentage cost of ignoring the discount and paying within 3 months? So you're not availing this 1.5% discount, you're ignoring this offer, and you will be paying in 3 months' time instead of making this payment within 1 month and availing a 1.5% discount. So how does it work? Quickly tell me what would be the cost. So let's quickly have a look at the cost involved. So instead of paying 2,500, you could have availed a discount of 1.5%. So how much does that come out to be? So So let me open up your calculators. So that's 2,500 multiplied with 1.5%. So that's 37.5. So how much would you be actually paying? Minus 2,500 if I do it. So that you would be eventually 2.5 is what you pay if you actually avail the offer, right? But now what you've done, you've ignored this offer. So this discount of 37.5% is what you literally ignored, divided by 2462.5 is what your 2-month interest rate would be. So that is equals to how much? Just very quickly do this for me, please. So that's 37.5. Just absolutely hate using this calculator. 2462.5. Please make use of your physical calculators. So that's equals to a discount of an interest rate, basically, which you will be paying off of 1.522. So that is the effective rate of interest that you will be charged. Now, this is for 2 months. Can I convert this back into an annualized percentage? So now this effectively is the cost of interest for the 2 months, because instead of paying in 1 month, you're paying it for 3 months. So 3 minus 1, 2 months interest rate it is. Can I just convert that into an annualized interest rate? So this plus one is equals to this divided by 6, and this is literally your rate. This is by divided by 6. Oh, sorry, let me just do it again. So that's 1.01515. So one mistake you make in this, you have to just type it over again. 1.05 2222, right? Yes, multiplied by 6, and just find out in terms of your rate. So just multiply this for me and tell me the answer, please. And minus 1 is what you're going to do then to solve it on a calculator for me. So 1 plus what is your cost? This is your 1.5.22% is the interest rate per. This is for a period of 2 months. So we need to find it for the annual interest, please. So that comes out to be equals to how much? So that's going to be equals to your 1 plus 0.01522 multiply with this 6. Minus 1. So very quickly solve it on your calculators for me. Solve it on your physical calculators and tell me know the answer, please. So that's an annual rate of 9.49, is it? Is it 9.49? 9.49 says Anshu. Well done. What about others? I think you've all given me option D already. So that's correct. Now let's move on to section B questions. Now these, again, they're going to be 3 objective test questions, 5 questions of 2 marks each. So that makes it a total of 30 marks. Now, before I actually begin with section B questions, is everybody okay with section A questions? You all know how to solve them? Any doubt, anything you want to ask here? Because we will be, quickly increasing our pace now. We really, really want to go and finish it off. Okay, so there is the question, and you have, so this one scenario is going to relate to 5 questions on section B, right? So this same scenario is going to be there, and with that you will be able to go back to and solve each one of these questions. So there you are very quickly. What is the future dollar value of the dinar receipt using a money market hedge? So money market hedge questions, we are done. Many money market hedge questions. You should all be able to do this. So you've been given your 6 months interest rate. Quickly go through this question, please. Everybody able to solve it? Park company is based in a country whose currency is the dollar. The company regularly imports goods denominated in euro and regularly sells goods denominated in euros as well. Two of the future transactions of the company are as follows. In 3 months, you're going to be paying 650,000 euros for imported goods. In 6 months, you will be receiving 12 million dinars for exported capital goods. Park company has the following exchange rates and interest rates available to it. So their spot exchange rate, dinar per dollar is given. 6 months forward rate is given. Spot exchange rate is given. 3 month forward rate is given as well. You've been given 6 months rate of borrowing as well as depositing. So 6 month rate is already given to you. So you're going to be borrowing dinars and you're going to be depositing what? You're going to be depositing your dollars here, right? So just mark your correct options. The finance director of Park Company believes that the upward sloping yield curve result reported in the financial media means that the general level of interest rates will increase in the future and therefore expects the reported 6 months interest rates to increase. So now when that is happening, what would you be doing? What is the future dollar value of the dinar using a money market hedge? So I'm going to borrow dinars and deposit dollars today itself instead of waiting for this 12-month receivable that I'm going to be in 6 months receivable of $12 million, which I'm going to have. So 12 million, let me open up your scratch pad. So 12 million multiplied with what? Multiplied with your 1.5%, it is right, 0.05. It's 5%, right? Let me just check. 0.5%, so 0.05, yes it is. So this is equals to how much? Let's open up your calculators again. So that's 12 million multiplied with your 1.005. That's equals to 12.6. And what I'm going to do with it, I'm going to be borrowing my requisite dinars today itself. So that is going to be equals to how much? That is going to be equals to multiplied with the requisite exchange rate today itself, which is equals to 57.52 is the offer. Why is it all of it getting highlighted? Sorry, I just had to use the entire thing has got highlighted. 57.52 is going to be the rate which I'm going to be making use of today. Spot rate for today. So I'm just going to highlight it in a different color now. So 57.52 is what my rate is. And my deposit rate is 4%. So this is going to be divided by equals to what? So that's going to be 57.52. And that is going to be borrowed at what rate? 4%, 1.04. So can you just solve this for me, please? So that's equals to, let me clear it again, 57.52. Multiply by 1.04 0.04. Please make use of your physical calculators. The reason why I'm using this is just because I want to show you the agony of using it. 559.82. So that comes out to be equals to how much? That comes out to be equals to 12.6 million. So that's 12.6 million. Let me just put that in millions. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Yes, divided by your 59.82. Can you just solve this for me? How much does that come out to be? $57.52, because we're going to exchange it today itself from the bank, right? We're going to raise this today itself because we have what? We have a receivable in 12 months time, right, Anshu? You've done these questions on money market hedge, right? So what do? We deposit enough money in the bank today itself to be able to raise this sufficient amount of 12 million dinars to hedge this risk in 6 months time, right? That is why we would be using this offer price today, as well as the borrow rate for the NAS and the deposit rate in dollars, right? Just go back to the questions just in case you have any doubt on this, please. Sakshi says, I have a doubt in yield curve topic, when it flattens, when it steepens, etc. Okay, Sakshi, so you need to go back to this yield curve topic. We saw that, you know, it's ideally taking a It's ideally taking a U shape, right? So whenever your cost of equity goes higher, it becomes more steeper at that point of time, right? And when it actually your cost of equity becomes, say you can equal, you know, it becomes equals, then that is the time when your yield curve is going to flatten, right, Sakshi? You can refer to the topic again, please. Go back to the lecture for your wherein we discussed about the yield curve. Meanwhile, is this question okay with everyone? Can I have the answer, please, very quickly? Can I have the answer for this, please, very quickly? So which out of these is the correct answer? Solve it, please. Solve this for me. So that's equals to 201602. Am I correct on this? Is that okay? Any doubts? Any doubts here? We've done many questions on the money market hedge. You should all be able to do this now, right? I'm still waiting for your confirmations. I will not go ahead. If you have any doubts, please feel free to ask. Okay, waiting again. Doubts or good to go ahead? Quickly, please tell me. We've got many questions to do. Clear, says Anshu. Clear, says Janvi. Okay, so now the same set of question is there on your left with a next part of your section B question. So very quickly do this then. The question is there. Remember various ways of handling our foreign currency risk. So indicate by clicking on the relevant boxes whether Park Company will find each of the following hedges to be effective or not effective in hedging the foreign currency risk of the two transactions. So leading the euro payment on its imported goods. Yes, definitely leading and lagging. All of these are important. Taking out forward exchange contract, again effective. Buying a tailor-made currency option for its future euro payment. Yes, definitely. These are all the ways in which we learned about managing to hedge our foreign currency risk. So all three are definitely effective ways in being able to handle our foreign currency risks, right? Okay with everyone? Okay, let me go through the scroll bar again. Literally like done the entire question. What do you want me to do? Okay, let me just quickly try and resize it. Sometimes that also works. So this is also something that you can be looking at. So you can increase or decrease the size of the window like this as well, just by dragging it. Okay, so quick question, next one again. Okay, so your local currency is the dollar. Which hedging methods will assist Park Company in reducing its overall foreign currency risk? Quickly, please. So you're having this currency already. You've got a 3 months payable in euros. You've got a receivable of 12 million dinars. So what is it that you should be doing? B says Jatin. So that's option two then. So taking out long-term euro-denominated loan. Why would you take on a euro-denominated loan? You already have a payable. If you take out another euro-denominated loan, this is definitely going to further increase your liability. This is not going to manage your risk, right? However, if I take out a dinar denominated overdraft, definitely this is something that is going to help me manage my foreign currency risk. So definitely two only is the correct option. Right, everyone? Is that okay? Let me know, please. Previous question, okay with everyone? Jatin got it right. What about others? Again, I'm waiting. Any questions? Anything anybody wants to ask in this question, please feel free to ask. Okay, let's move on to the next one then. So indicate by clicking on the relevant boxes whether the following statements are correct or incorrect. So quickly let me know, please. Purchasing power parity can be used to predict the forward exchange rate. Purchasing power parity doesn't help predict the forward exchange rate. It just tells you what? It just tells you the spot rate which is going to be there. So what it helps us tell, it helps us predict the future spot rate. So this is incorrect. International Fisher effect. Remember, what is international Fisher effect? When you equated your interest rate parity to your purchasing power parity, can be used to predict the real interest rate. Does it help us predict the real interest rate? It does not help us predict the real interest rate. However, it is something which helps us tell that this is the, you know, if we assume that there is the real interest rate in both the economies is the same, then it helps us negate the impact of inflation instead. So yes, both the statements are incorrect, right? Remember, we have done this, right? Yes, says Jatin. What about others? Is Jatin the only one answering questions now? Where are the others? Okay, great. So I literally have to like scold you to get an answer out of you now. Okay, so let's move on to the next question. What is it that we have not read? We've read it. So can you just help us scroll? Okay, so which of the following statements is consistent with an upward sloping yield curve? So I think this will help resolve Sakshi's query as well. So very quickly. Upward sloping simply means that as and when your risk is increasing, so is your cost of interest as well. So the risk of borrowers defaulting on their loans increases during the duration of the lending. So obviously that is what simply gives it a upward sloping yield curve. So that's like a normal yield curve. Wonderful. That's right, Anshu. So let's move forward. Okay, so the next question. Next question of section B, giving us our next set of 2 marker questions, 5 2 marker questions each. So very quickly go through this question first. So while I'm going through the question, I can literally increase or decrease my size of the window so I can, you know, read the entire question in one go. That is again something which is allowed. The system, you know, has this functionality in it. So what is the equity market value of Coral Company to 2 decimal places? You've been given sufficient and appropriate information. So 7.8 million ordinary shares. Nominal value is 25 per share. Currently trading at 7.1 per share. G is given to be 8%. Can you just literally very quickly out of this information find out your equity market value of the Coral Company? So number of shares is what? Number of shares is 7.8 divided by 2.5, 0.25. So my number of shares is 7.8 divided by 0.25. So what does that come out to be? $7.8 million divided by 0.25, 31.2 million shares. And what is the value per share? Value per share currently is trading at 7.10, right? 7.10. So can you just find out your total equity value, which will be equals to 7.10 multiplied by 31.2 million shares that are there. So very quickly, your answer has to be to 2 decimal places, to 221.52 is what is my answer. Let me just put that down. So 221.52 is my answer, right? Everybody familiar with it? Everybody okay with it? Let's have a look at your answers. 221.52, that's wonderful. Let's quickly hop on to the next one. Assuming conversion, what is the market value of each loan note? So what's happening here? You also have 7% convertible loan notes. The loan notes are redeemable after 6 years. So they are redeemable after 6 years. At their nominal value of 100 per loan note, or can be converted after 6 years. to 10 ordinary shares of Coral Company per loan board. So it can be converted after 6 years to into 10 ordinary shares per loan note. The loan notes are state traded on the capital market. The before tax cost of debt is 5% and the company pays corporation tax of 20%. So very quickly find out this after conversion, what is the market value of each of the loan notes? So they can be converted in 6 years time. So find out the value of the share in 6 years time first. Share prices are expected to increase by 8% for the foreseeable future. So what is going to be the share price in 6 years time? Okay, getting some answers. So let's start. So let's have a look here. So what do I have? I have some share price in 6 years time is going to be equals to 7.10 multiplied by, it is increasing 1.8%, right? 0.8 raised to the power 6. Can you just solve this for me? And how many shares are there? There are 10 shares. So my value, my conversion value in 6 years time is equals to how much? My conversion value is equals to 112.67, is it? I'm just taking it from your question. So 112.67 is the conversion value. Just solve this for me very quickly. Would you rather redeem it? Nominal value is redeemable. The loan and limit redeemable at nominal value of 100 or 112.6. So obviously we'll be redeeming it at 112.6. So what would be the market value at that point of time? You will be earning interest. It's a 7% convertible loan note, right? So interest will be earned on it for 6 years. That's going to be equals to 7 is the amount of interest that you will be earning on it for your 6 years. So take your annuity tables, please. So open up your annuity table here from the formula sheet. Find out your annuity for 6 years at cost of debt is 5, at 5%. So very quickly find out your annuity table from here. So go on to the formula sheet. Pick up your relevant figure, please. Annuity table for your 6 years, 5.076, right? So 5.076, everybody able to identify? Into 5.076. This obviously, you remember, this is going to be your interest value. Then you're going to be having your conversion value in the year 6 as well, which is going to be converted at 112.67 at the end of your 6 years. So discount factor at 5% for 6 years is equals to how much? Go back to your formula sheet again. Discount factor 5%, 6 year is 0.746. So this is how you take your figures, 0.746. Solve this for me very quickly. How much does it come out to be? Solve this, please. Okay. No answers coming in, so I'll have to solve it. So 7 multiplied by 5.076 is equals to 35. 0.532, and this is going to be equals to 112.67 multiplied by 0.746 equals to 84.05, right? This plus 35.532. 119.58 is my answer. Can you all vouch for it? 58 to two decimal places, right? Let's get rid of it. 119.58. Okay, option C is what I will be selecting. Is that okay with everyone? Option C. Why are we considering interest amount before tax? Okay, good question, Kush. Let's have a look at it, because what is the market value of conversion? So yes, if I'm finding out the total overall cost, I need to take off my, if you remember when we took out our VAT, that is when we are taking off the element of tax. Here we just come calculating it in total. Right? Remember, always remember this, please do not confuse yourself when you actually calculate the cost of capital to the companies from the end consumer's perspective. That is when you take off tax. Here it is going to be overall. Right? I think Jatin and Kush had the same query. So here we are calculating from the company's perspective. Your interest, your taxation perspective is taken off when you're considering it from the individual who has invested from his perspective, because he will get his income net of tax, right? I hope this is clear with everyone. Please do not confuse yourself here. So when we calculate the overall VAC, that is where we always take off the taxation amount. Okay. So let's move on to the next question then. Very quickly, I want you to answer. Okay, so which of the following statements about the equity market value of Coral Company is or are true? The equity market value will change frequently due to the capital market forces. So yes, that's right. And if the capital market is semi-strong form efficient, the equity market value will not be affected by the release to the public of insider information. No, if it is semi-strong efficient, it will be able to get affected. So the two is not true. Over time, the equity market value of Coral Company will follow a random walk. That's what the theory says. So yes, 1 and 3 only indeed are the correct options. So be rightly identified by everyone. So that's great. Let's move on. Okay, quick question. Which of the following are assumptions made by the dividend growth model? So quickly assess on that. Investors make rational decisions. Yes, that is an assumption. Dividends show either constant growth or zero growth, that is again an assumption. And the dividend growth rate is less than the cost of equity, again, is the correct option. So yes, all three are actually assumptions of the dividend growth model. Well done, Anshu. Let's quickly move on. Why might valuations of the equity and loan notes of Coral Company be necessary? So why do you think valuation of the equity and loan notes is something which is something that, you know, the company might be looking for? Why value? Very quickly. If the company is planning to go for market for additional finance, you absolutely need valuation. Company needs to be valued for corporation tax purpose. No, taxation you can simply do likewise also without valuing the company. Company has received a takeover bid from Viral Company. Yes, so 1 and 3 both are correct. So I would go in for option B. Rightly identified by Anshu, Jatin, Ketki. Well done. Let's move on to the next question very quickly then. Okay, so what do we have here? Quick question. I think what I'll do instead of doing this question now, because we've literally gone through section B questions, I'm going to quickly move on. I'm just going to randomly select some options here. And I'm going to move on to my section C questions, just because I want to show you how to do this. Is that okay with everyone? Shall we skip this question and move on to section C questions? Would that be okay? Please let me know if everybody is comfortable doing that. We've done lots and lots of question practice. So the agenda here is not to do question practice, but to familiarize you with the entire aspect of it. So I'm just quickly marking some random answers here and moving on to the next question. So I'm just hopping onto your section C question here. Anything, I'm just marking randomly. What is it? Okay, so now we are on section C. This section of the exam contains two constructed response questions. You're going to be having two questions of 20 marks each, covering your 40 marks of the exam. In the live exam, obviously, you will be given a reconstructed response area to pour in your answer. So we know that. So there we are. We have the question given here. And to do our calculations, the examiner has very politely given us this. I don't know why it keeps on popping, even though I've like deleted it 100 times almost. So, but in the exam, if you use it, delete it, it will not be there. Don't worry about it, right? So now it's a full-fledged question. We've done many, many questions like this. So I will not be sparing out time to actually solve this question here. But what I want to show you is that this is how the question is going to look like. So this is how the question is going to look like. We will be given a scenario followed by a question. So you're required to calculate VAT of the company. Most of questions seems exactly same like in our practice and revision kit. That's exactly why I've always stressed so much on doing question, each and every question from your practice and revision kit, right, Jatin? Because I really don't want my students to have any surprises in the exam. So that's why I've literally done myself also, we've done so many questions and I've stressed it upon so many times that please do each and every question so that you literally are not surprised on the day of the exam. Thank you, Jatin, for, vouching for what I've always said, that yes, the questions in the exam are going to be more or less like what is there in your practice and revision kits already. So please be very, very thorough with each and every question of it. So we've done many questions on VAC. You should all be able to do this. The point here is not to do more question practice, but to go through and have a look at how to attempt. So we're going to calculate the cost of equity shares. We're going to calculate the cost of preference shares, cost of loan notes, as well as cost of bank loan, and calculate your overall VAC. Is that okay with everyone? Is everybody confident on being able to solve this VAC question? Yes, says Kush. What about others? I hope all of you who've done the classes with me will be confident at this point of time, and you should all be able to do this. Sakshi, Janvi, Sony, well done. So yes, I know Ketki. So that actually is very, happy for me to know that you are all confident in it. But remember, I'm only showing you a mock exam today. You all have to select one another, mock exam, and sit and do the entire mock exam yourself. Because at the end of the day, it is not me who's going to give your paper. It is you who's going to give your paper. So sit down with the right exam technique, try and time yourself, give yourself the 3 hours which are going to be available, and do an actual mock exam. Save it, submit it to me. So I will be able to check it for you. So let's move on to the next question then. Okay. Next question, 4 marks. Explain the meaning of the terms business risk and financial risk. So it's something that you have to write down. So look what the examiner has given you. The examiner has given you a blank workspace, very similar to a Word document wherein you can just write down business risk. You can explain what business risk is. Very important for you to highlight, bold your headers, please. You could underline your header as well just to make it look more presentable. Business, I need to remove all of this. So remove bold, remove underline. Business risk refers to the risks faced by the business as part of the industry that the business operates in. It is blah, 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 blah. You all know your theory, right? But what I want to show you here is how to structure your answer. So what you're going to do here is you're going to put, make use of your bold, make use of your underline for your headers, and then just go blah, blah, blah on your answers. Always relate. Relate your answers to the case study given. Please do that. I'm requesting you. This is the last paper of your skills level. The examiner expects you to start behaving like a professional. So the examiner wants to see whether you are ready to go to the professional level or not. So please give your answers an extremely professional look. Is that okay with everyone? Everybody understands how to structure these answers? I want everybody's confirmation, please. These are very, very simple, yet very, very effective examination techniques, which I want each one of you to go through. Great. So let's move on to the next question then. Okay, so again, a discursive question, like I've been saying to you, very, very important aspect for section C is going to be your theory questions. So discuss the key features of a rights issue as a way of raising equity finance. So talk about rights issue, talk about what it means. So you can begin with the definition probably. So begin the definition, discuss the pros and cons of rights issue. Advise, always close your answer with an advice that, you know, what would you advise to Gardner Company about issuing rights issue. So make your answers look so wonderfully well, as if laid down by a professional. What if we mistyped any word while writing the answer? How will we mark them? Mistyping of words. So your grammatical mistakes are not going to be, you know, given any negative marking for, as long as, so supposedly I like put down this, wording, the spelling of definition incorrect. So please, I do not have to stress about, oh my God, I've written one spelling wrong. Your grammatical mistakes, your spelling mistakes are not going to give you any negative marking, as long as your answer is, you know, something that makes sense. Your spelling is something that the examiner is probably able to understand what you were trying to say, and probably, you know, just mistyped one alphabet out of it. So do not stress too much about it. If your sentence doesn't make a sense, probably, you know, you should be worried about that. What I'm trying to communicate, probably the examiner is not able to understand. But apart from that, everything else is fine. Right, Ketki? Wonderful. So let's proceed. I'm going to show you these model answers as well. But let me just go through the questions first. Okay, so we've gone through the questions. Let's, we've done the entire workspace. Okay, still doesn't allow me to navigate. What's open? Okay, let's have a look at what's open here. Okay, so now, again, the next question, you are required to calculate the NPV of the investment project and comment upon its financial acceptability. So calculate as well as comment. NPV question, any surprises? Were you all expecting an NPV question to be coming up? I hope this is absolutely no surprise to anyone. Okay, so Jatin has a question. Let's come on that. Lost it. Just one second. Ma'am, we need to focus on word limit in theory questions. Any limit prescribed by ACCA or only to needs focus and explain the exact concept for particular question to examiner. That's exactly what you need to do, Jatin. There is no word limit. It's a professional level exam. Writing, you know, just going on and on and on is not going to help you. Stick to your time limit, please. So instead of a word limit, there is a time limit which you have. Please do not go overboard on your time limit. Make your answers crisp. Make your answers compact. Make your answers extremely relevant to your question, right? So that is what is going to give you good marks. Okay, so NPV question, we all expected an NPV question. We've done lots and lots of question practice on NPV on part D of our syllabus. So everybody should be able to do it. Is that okay with everyone? You all are confident of being able to do an NPV question. I can give you a minute to read through the question once if you want to, just to, you know, give you the confidence that the question doesn't have any surprises. Something that we all have already done for. Okay. Let me just try and, why is it not sticking? Hold on. Okay. So we all know this. Please quickly go through the question. I'm giving you all a minute to just to read through the question once so that you all are confident that we have done many questions of this sort and you will all be able to do this as well. So quick 5 minutes I'm giving you just to read and, you know, get a confidence on the question. Okay, great. So that's a real, you know, pleasure to see everybody pour in a yes. Because we've done so many questions like this, I was very, very, you know, confident you will all be able to do questions like this. Okay, what have I not scrolled? Let me just scroll it a couple of times. Okay, I know we've not viewed the entire screen because I've not done the question. Don't worry about it. I'm happy to move forward. Oh, good Lord, why not allowing me? Okay, yes. Now it should be able to allow me. Just, you know, scroll down your screen up and down on these navigator buttons here, just in case your system is not allowing you to go forward. So what do you have here? The second part of the question talks about determine the NPV of the optimum investment schedule for Delta companies. So what you need to do is find out an optimum schedule and determine the NPV of it. So there you are. How would you be doing it? Tell me very quickly, how would you be doing it? On what basis would you be finding out your optimum schedule? Projects are divisible. Well done, everyone. So yes, you're going to make use of your profitability index, to find out the optimum schedule, and you're going to be finding out your net present value. Wonderful. I'm so glad that everybody was able to find this out. So we've done, again, we've done lots and lots of questions like this. So no surprises for us here as well. Okay, let me just scroll up and down. Okay, as expected, theory question. Discuss the reasons why hard and soft capital rationing occurs. So I told you that this is a very, very frequently asked question as well. If not this question, but definitely your section C is going to have a good mix of your number crunching questions with your out and out theory questions as well. So you should all be able to do this. So again, I'm just going to structure my answer. I'm going to just structure it beautifully, highlighting my header, explaining my header. Remember, as part of your explanation, you first talk about a generic explanation, then you relate it to the scenario. Please do not forget that, right? This is something that you should know by now, like the back of your hand, really. So soft capital rationing. So this is, again, I'm just gonna highlight my header and I'm gonna follow the same steps to be able to get my 5 marks, which are there, right? Everybody okay? Just, yeah, one more thing I wanted to show you here. In fact, let me just do this again for you. Okay. So if I copy paste anything from my question to my screen, what happens really is that I lose out on formatting that there might be. Let me just show this to you like this. So if I copy paste all of it here, so what happens is that I lose out on the formatting which was there in the question. So all of this has come together. I might be required to settle down or just, you know, structure my answer in the same way as I've done my copy paste. So the formatting gets lost is something that you should be familiar with whenever you're copying pasting from your CBE, from your, you know, from the question itself, right? Everybody okay with it? Okay, quick question again. Discuss 2 ways in which the risk of an investment project can be assessed. Do you all know 2 ways to assess your investment project risk? Do you all know 2 ways? You can put down any of the different models that we've done, be it the CAPM model, be it the profitability index. You can just talk about any 2 ways to be able to manage your risk, right? Everybody okay with it? So now, because I've literally gone through all the questions, now pops up my review screen, wherein what is it that I'm able to see that wonderfully I've completed some questions. I've obviously left a few questions because we did not go through each and every question here. So what I'm gonna do now is that it just reflects that I have done this. Remember this question I had flagged. So this is how it is showing here that you had flagged this. You probably want to do something more to it. If I put on click here, I directly go on to this particular question, which I had flagged for myself. Remember? So what I'm going to do now is go on to the navigator button. Probably close this flag. Click on my next to reach on to my end exam button. Now, what I want to show you now is that as soon as I end my exam, what happens and what is it that you could do? Okay, so I've done this. I'm happy with my whatever complete, incomplete answers I have. I'm happy to end my exam here. Remember, in the real exam, if you end your exam once, you will not be able to go back to your exam. So am I happy to end my exam? Is there anything anybody wants to ask here? Is there anything anybody wants to ask? Any questions here whatsoever? Okay, wonderful. So let me end the exam. Are you sure you want to end? Yes, I'm sure I want to end. Are you again sure you want to end? Yes, I am damn sure I want to end. So what have I done? I've literally ended my exam. And now, because this is the practice platform, this exam is something which is now available for me to review and self-mark as well. I can obviously resit this exam because it's only a practice platform, but not on the real exam. You will never be able to resit it unless obviously if you fail, but not the same exam although. So you press on exit. I go on to mark button here. Self-marking is what I'm looking for. I go on to my FM exam. Which one was it, the one that we are doing? Okay, practice test 2 is what we are doing, right? So I click on self-mark. This is again, all functionalities available on your ACCA practice platforms. Please, please, please do this. Do not just attempt a question, attempt a mock exam. Self-mark yourself as well. Look at what you've done right. Look at what you could have done better. So this is just going to self-mark our answers. So we're just quickly scrolling on. And what I'm going to do is just move on and show you the theory aspects of how the theoretical questions are to be written. So the question is given here, true and false is given, whatsoever was there. An explanation of it is given to you here. So this is just marking my question. So this is how we are just doing it. ACCA results for exam will announce in the same time once we have submit the exam. No, Jatin. Your result is going to be coming in approximately a month and a half later. This is not your on-demand exam, which is going to evaluate it, at the same time. Okay, so I'm just jumping on to some theory questions, which I want to show you that how the examiner has done the answer. So section A, section B, we're just jumping on because this is something that we've just done categorically. Okay, so from question number 31 comes in your section C questions. So let's quickly have a look at it. Okay, so this was solving it. Okay, so this is how I could have solved the question. So this is something that I can make use of in order to self-assess. Question sample answer. Click here to see the sample answer. So we're just clicking here and pops in your sample answer of how you should have done the question, right? Let me show you a theory question. Okay, I'm just gonna again roll up to the sample answer here. So this is how you could have written your answer. So just review your answer with the one given here. Okay. So what are we talking about? We're talking about the entire question here, talking about business risk, talking about financial risk, and I'm gaining my 4 marks. Right? Let me show you a long question as well on it. Okay, let's roll on. Okay, so this is how Let me just open up the question. There, your probability analysis, CAPM, this is how you could present your answers neatly, legibly, and nicely presented, right? Everybody okay with it? I hope you're all able to understand the importance of writing your answers very, very neatly, right? Does everybody second on this? Does everybody agree upon this? Is everybody confident of the CBE practice platform? Are you all confident that you will be able to tackle and handle an entire question, an entire exam yourself? This confidence will only come, believe you me, when you actually do an entire mock exam yourself. So when you actually submit it and you review your answers, it will show you an entire, you know, what you've scored as well, because we obviously did not do the entire question here. So when I actually go on to it and you will do it yourself, you will be able to roll out your total marks as well, right? Everybody okay with it? So there is a floppy button wherein you need to save your answer, submit, and then you can review your answer. Okay, so is everybody confident of the CBE practice platform now? I need everybody's confirmation, please. Any queries, anything anybody wants to ask, this is very, very important for your exam. Great. I'm waiting for everybody to give me a confirmation. So you submit on the floppy button, which is the save tab, which is there. You save your answers as a PDF, and then because it will be saved as a PDF, you can just email it to me. Right, Anshu? Make sure you do it before the 25th, please. And you send me which mock exam you've literally done and what is the answer that you've submitted. You can take up any, Nandu. You can take up, let me just, I think it's better if I actually tell you which one to take up, because, okay, let me just assign you from here, because the platform didn't have the option to get this assigned to you. I will be assigning it to you. Just give me a second. Let's take up one good question, one full-fledged mock exam. Past exam is what we are looking at. Okay, so you can literally submit to me this December, September, December specimen exam. So all of you can submit this September, December 2020 exam, and I can definitely review and get back to you. So my email ID is acca@vglearningdestination.com. You must submit before 25th of May for me to check and get back to you. Okay, this is only section C. Okay, so then you can do this FM practice test 1. So you can all do FM practice test 1. This is a full-fledged question. Your section A and section B will automatically get checked. Section C, you can submit to me. What is the fail safe during the exam if there is a power or internet problem? Jatin, really, you just have to ensure that A, you're on a LAN connection. B, obviously nobody can predict that, you know, there is going to be no power failure, but make sure that you are, you know, sufficiently backed up with a backup facility, which is going to be there. The examiner usually waits for, say, about maximum of 5 minutes for you to reconnect. If your system, your exam doesn't get reconnected within 5 minutes, unfortunately, the exam stands terminated. However, if you reconnect within 5 minutes, you have a backup plan, you know, a backup internet connection available, a backup power facility available on you, then you can resume your exam from there itself, because the system is automatically saving on whatever you are doing. Can we reconnect with our mobile hotspot? Hotspots are not allowed, Anshu, please. I want everybody to go through the FAQs on remote exams on ACCA's website. I've literally sent it across in various groups which I have so many times. Please go through each and every FAQ on your remote exam. So let's not, you know, keep ourselves, maintain any surprises for ourselves. Your laptops should be sufficiently charged. There is lots and lots to it, really. I mean, I would really require to take up a separate session on it altogether, but we've already done that. I hope you all attended the Practice to Pass webinar, which was arranged for you. I think it was the 14th of May, right? If not, what I'll do, I'll share the recording of it again in the WhatsApp group. You can please refer to it. Yes, you can do that, Sakshi, but again, this is something which, you know, the connection is not stable, so this might interrupt your exam, and the, you know, the system itself might just stop your exam from the back end. So that is something which obviously, you know, you don't want to take a risk of. So fixed LAN connection is preferred. So please, you know, rely upon that. Everybody okay? Now let's take a quick 10 minutes break. I want to quickly do a quick revision of the entire syllabus so that I'm confident that all my students are 100% ready and they only need to revise from this phase onwards. And we'll be, you know, very quickly doing what is like extremely, extremely important, right? So quick 10 minutes break and then we shall reconnect. Okay, do we have everyone back? Shall we start? So I'm just going to take you through these very important revision notes towards your financial management paper, which you need to revise a day before the exam. So these are like quick, you can say, you know, quick summary pages for the entire content. So just go through it one by one for every chapter, just to quickly revise, you know, a day before the exam that, okay, this is what we had done on it. This is what, you know, this for this topic, these are the five key notes. So this is like very, very brief revision notes for you to be able to go through the entire content, right? So there we are. Let's quickly start. Skills we've learned, approaches again we've learned. I was not able to hear you at the end about which you said about the internet connectivity because of my internet issue. Could you please repeat it again? Okay, sure, Khushbu. I will repeat it for you that for your remotely invigilated in your CBE exam, for your June exam, make sure that you have a LAN, fixed LAN connection on which you have your, you know, you are giving your exam, your laptop should be fully charged in case of any power or, you know, outage. Let me just show this to you. I mean, this is coming up so frequently. Let me just spare like 5 minutes on this. Okay, let's go on to our ACCA platform, global website, please. Okay, let me just open up the home page. Remote, not on demand. I've sent this in the WhatsApp group as well, which we maintain for VG Learning. Just in case, because you had so many doubts over it, so I am just sharing this link with all of you again here in the chat box. Please go through this FAQ link. This will answer all of your queries. I think it's just gone to Khushbu. So let me just send it across to everyone again. There you are. Let's just quickly come on to the doubt. So these are all your important FAQs. Okay, where did that technical disruption thing go? Bear with me. Wrong FAQ I've sent, which is just bear with me. Where is my remote FAQ? Wait, let me just go to it again. Remote invigilation, frequently asked questions. So you have to search the right thing. FAQs. Was it this one? Okay, I'm unable to just quickly grasp it. I have it on my phone, so I'll be sharing it with you. Don't worry. Meanwhile, let me just find this here, remote. Invigilation. FAQ. Bear with me, please. So it just pops up the same thing. You could also go onto the content hub for specifically for Indian students, which is there. I'll just show you that as well. Just bear with me for a second. This is the India content hub. Yes, so this has all relevant information specifically for Indian students. Just bear with me for 1 second, please. So sorry, I just received a call and I thought it was the important call which I couldn't miss. Okay, so where are we? Content, study support, resources, podcast, must watch. So I think it's a little complicated here. I'll come back to you with the link of the FAQs. But somehow I cannot trace it here. It was very much here on the website itself. Probably they've put it down for some additions to be made, because sometimes this happens. But because I could see an FAQ on Pakistan, which is very strange here. FAQ is remote. Where is my remote FAQ? Okay, nonetheless, I have it on my phone already, so I will be sharing that with you. So I will share the link and you can go through it. Meanwhile, just to answer your query, Khushbu, you need to have a fixed LAN connection on which you're giving your exam. If your exam gets disrupted for, say, about 5 minutes because of some power outage or something that happens, and you're able to reconnect within 5 minutes on the backup, then yes, your exam might continue. But if it goes beyond 5 minutes and the examiner is unable to contact you, your exam will get revoked. and thus you will not be able to complete your exam. So please make sure that you are trying for minimum disruptions during the exam. There is an entire question on the FAQs, which is here, which I absolutely don't understand. Why is it not showing here? It should be right here itself. Remote frequently asked. If it shows up and gives me the right link, I'll share that. Okay, finally, I've got what I was looking for. It's sometimes a little funny the way it acts. Okay, so what happens? What happens? Break. You know, all, I hope you all know that you can take 5 minutes break during your exam. You obviously have to inform your invigilator. It's like basically a washroom break, which is allowed to you. Okay. So for COVID-19, this is your entire link of remote FAQs, which you can look to. Please make sure that you are reviewing all of this. Before you actually sit for your exam. So scrap paper, no, it is not allowed. Let me just share this link with everyone in the group. I also will share it on the WhatsApp group. Okay, so there is the set of questions, which I'm sure you all are already aware of, right? Any questions you have? Are we good to start with our revision? Any further questions? Anything anybody wants to ask? I'm waiting. Okay, great. So let's just start with the revision phase then. Where is my book? Here it is. Okay. So let's quickly, I'm going to just very quickly ponder upon this revision. We've done all of it in much, much detail, but this is just like a quick revision phase. So the first we started off with our financial management function. So just quickly go through this. If you have any queries whatsoever, please feel free to ask. There you are. Quick revision notes for you on the screen. I will be sharing these notes with you on WhatsApp group as well, because I want each one of you to go through these notes just a day before the exam as well. Ketki, I'll come to working capital, then you can ask your doubt regarding working capital as well. So just starting from the first lecture, the first chapter itself. Okay. Just setting the tone of the entire curriculum. We did all of these. Any doubts? Anything anybody wants to ask here? Any doubts? Any doubts? Anything anybody wants to ask? No doubt. Wonderful. So let's proceed. On to the next one, wherein we did the financial management environment. We started off with the economic environment of what happens, how businesses get impacted by not just only decisions which are taken within the organization, but with decisions which are taken outside the organization as well. So the macroeconomic environment with your policies absolutely impacts businesses. Right? Quickly go through this, please. Any queries? Anything anybody wants to ask? Any doubt? Any doubt? You have to answer, please. I wouldn't be able to clear doubts if you don't ask a doubt or tell me it's good to go ahead. Okay, so that's no doubt. Working capital, there you are. Ketki, please feel free to pour in your query. Quickly revise this first. We did all of these. Right? What is letter of credit? Letter of credit is issued by the bank that you've been given a credit facility. So basically it has all the terms and conditions of what the, you know, the credit has been agreed upon for. Ma'am, would increase in inventory level result in increase in working capital? Yes. So what do you have in your working capital? You add up all your receivables, your inventory levels, you decrease from it your payables, and any increase in your inventory levels is going to increase your total working capital requirement. So yes, that is right, Ketki. PNR kit question 75 is wrong. Okay, so I wouldn't be able to go back to the PNR kit and check for question number 75. Please review the question and just review the answer for it as well. And depends upon what's happening with the other things as well, right? So here in your question, I'm just only comparing inventory level with your net working capital. Supposingly, with your inventory level, your net payables are going down, then obviously your net working capital is going to go down. So it depends upon the numbers really, Ketki, right? But yes, overall, if I look at it, then increase in working capital is going to further increase your net working capital requirement. Other things remaining same, right, Ketki? Wonderful. Any other doubt? Anybody wants to ask anything here? Shall we go ahead? Are we good to go ahead with this? Okay. There you are. We did cash management models. Remember your Baumol model, your Miller-Orr model. Why cash management is important? Working capital finance, treasury management. Any doubt here? Any doubt here? Anything anybody would like to ask? If non-current assets are sold, then what will be the impact on working capital? So if you're selling off your non-current assets, what will be the impact on working? What is working capital, Ketki, in the first place? Does it include your non-current assets? It doesn't include your non-current assets, right? However, if you're selling off something, your cash might go up. Your cash in hand is going to go up, right? So what happens to your net working capital? You've increased your asset, right? You've increased your net asset of cash. So how does it impact? You tell me. Is it going to impact your working capital? Only by the way that if your cash realized from the sale of working capital comes back to the business and you are probably paying off your payables or, you know, you're buying more inventory from it, in that way it was going to impact, but not otherwise. Right, Ketki? Okay. Investment decision, very, very important. We spent very much time on this as well. So you should all be well familiar with all these concepts. Any question, please feel free to ask. We started off with simple techniques. We introduced the time value and what discounting is all like. We then moved on to very important techniques of NPV and IRR. Right? Any question here? Any question in NPV IRR? Waiting, please. Okay. Let's just add a little bit of variety to it then. We introduced taxation, the impact of working capital. We introduced how NPV layout is going to bring across an impact of your tax allowable depreciation, the savings made on it, how inflation kicks in and changes your figures, right? Everybody okay with it? Any question here? Okay, so I'm getting no. Wonderful. So we can then proceed to project appraisal and our risk sensitivity analysis, your probability analysis, all of these techniques that we did here. Done. Okay. Specific investment decisions. We then did lots of questions on asset replacement, lease versus buy, what capital rationing is all about. Any questions, any doubts here? Any doubts here? Waiting for your doubts or your confirmations. Okay. On to the next one then. Sources of finance. Where is all the money going to come from? Quickly review it. Remember these terms, please. So these are excellent notes, revision notes that you can refer to a day before your exam just to quickly revise all of your concepts. Any question? Any question here? Okay, that's great. I'm feeling so happy to look at the fact that you're all confident. Dividend policy. Quickly go through it, please. Any questions? Anything anybody would like to ask here? It's very nicely, you know, it can literally form the base or the structure of your theory questions as well. So please, again, I'm requesting everybody to please go through these notes a day before the exam as well. Cost of capital. Everybody okay with it? Is it necessary to use IRR method to calculate cost of redeemable debt because there is a less cumbersome method as well? No, it is important. If it is a redeemable debt, then you must make use of the IRR method only. Right, Jatin? For redeemable debt, we use the IRR technique. For irredeemable debt, we make use of the perpetuity formula. Okay, so quickly. Risk and return, cost of equity, we did the dividend growth model, we did the CAPM model. Cost of debt. WACC. Right? Any doubts? Anything anybody would like to ask here? When we subtract risk-free return from the expected return from the market in the CAPM model. Yes, that's what we do in the CAPM model. There you are. So what it is? We have our expected return from the market minus your risk-free return plus your return from the market minus your risk-free return. That is how you calculate your equity beta, your equity return from the market. So your equity return is equals to your risk-free return plus your expected return from the market minus your risk-free return. Anshu, is that okay? I really couldn't understand your question. In sub questions, we did not subtract risk-free return when you were already given the risk, you know, the premium in the market risk premium, then that is when you need not subtract because your risk, market risk premium is what? Market risk premium is your risk-free return, your expected return from the market minus your risk-free return. So this thing here is already subtracted for you and given in the question in the form of market risk premium. That is when we need not subtract it. Right, Anshu? Because this particular figure of RM minus RF is already given in the form of the market risk premium to you. Right? Okay, so there was one more question here. Let's come back to the question. Jatin says, in IRR method, we can use any rate for calculating NPVA and NPVB as it's hard hit and trial method. Yes, it is a hit and trial method. Obviously, you know, either the examiner will give you some sort of a leeway in terms of what approximately you should be starting off with, or just start off with 10% as a, you know, a bare minimum start, just to find out what your next percentage should be looking like. Right, Jatin? Okay, great. Any other question? Anything anybody would like to ask here? Okay, then move on to the structure then. Any doubts? Any doubts here? Okay, so let's proceed then. Quickly, please. Project specific cost of capital. Remember, marginal cost of capital. We did specific steps in it. We've literally covered the entire syllabus in much detail. So you should all be well familiar with this. Okay to go ahead? Any doubt? Any doubt? Anything anybody would like to ask here? Okay. So let's move on to the next one then. Business valuations. When needed, how do we do it? Just go through them one by one. Activity 2 of this chapter, how we calculated PE ratio 21.2 in this question. Jatin, please refer to the class. I will not be able to go back to a particular question unless you have a doubt in the, you know, overall concept. I will come and solve this question for you separately. So just connect to me on a one-on-one. Right? Conceptually, any doubt here? There was a missing figure in that question. So probably there was a typing mistake, Jatin. Sometimes, you know, the book is not like 100% right. So there could be a typing mistake in the question. I cannot recall the question. So I really cannot comment, but just go through the question and the answer. If you reckon that, you know, probably there was something which was missing here, then probably, you know, you could look at it. Market efficiency. Okay. So we did three types of market efficiency, Anshu, right? Wherein the market was weak from efficient, the market was semi-strong efficient, or the market is extremely strongly efficient. In a weak form in market efficiency, your stock prices are only reflective of whatever historic information is there in public domain. In a semi-strong efficient market, what is happening along with your historic information, whatever information is there, which is available to the public at large, is going to be absorbed by your share prices. And in a strong from market efficient, along with your publicly available information, any information which is private, which is like insider dealing, will also reflect the share prices. Your share price, your market is going to be extremely volatile and is going to be extremely, you know, being able to clear and adapt to whatever new information, good or bad, that gets rolled out by, you know, about the company. So if there's any good investment that you've done with a project, you know, giving you a positive NPV, then the very next day, what we see is that the share prices in the market starts increasing. Why? Because the market is strong form efficient. Right? Right, Anshu? Wonderful. So let's proceed. Foreign currency risk. Quickly go through the notes, please. Any questions, any doubts here? Foreign currency receipt and foreign currency payable, only method of calculation part. So what is happening when you have a foreign currency receipt? You need to create a hedge for yourself to be able to manage this risk, right? And similarly, when you have a foreign currency payable, you need to create a hedge for yourself so that in 6 months' time, when you actually are required to pay this amount, there is no risk. You will always end up in a situation of no profit, no loss, because in one, you know, in one currency fluctuation, if you face a loss in the other currency, you will be facing an equivalent amount of profit. So that is how you hedge your risk by creating a hedge for yourself. Now, this hedge could be created by the way of forwards. You could create, you know, make use of future agreements. You could create a money market hedge, which is like an artificial hedge which you're creating for yourself. But yes, that is how you're managing your risk towards your foreign currency receipts as well as your foreign currency payables. Right, Jatin? Great, so let's proceed. So this is again ways of managing your foreign currency risk. So if there is a receipt that you have, what do? You create a foreign currency loan for yourself. If there's a payable that you have, if there's a payment that you have, you create a foreign currency investment for yourself. While money market hedge, how do we choose buy or sell price? So similarly here, Anshu, it says that if you have a receipt, you're going to create a foreign currency loan for yourself. What do you do with this loan? Do you need foreign currency for yourself? No, right? So you're going to sell this foreign currency and convert it into local currency. So that is how, just you know, logically follow it. Right, Anshu? So if you have a foreign currency receipt, you're going to create yourself a foreign currency loan. You don't want to do anything with this loan at the moment. You're going to convert it into the local currency using the buy and sell rates. So I'm going to sell off this foreign currency. So take the buy rate of the local currency. That what is the bank doing? Is the bank selling or is the bank buying? Remember, we had done this very, very categorically in the class. So then accordingly, what do you do for yourself? You would deposit that money in the local account, create, you know, earn interest on it, and then be able to manage this risk, right? So the simple formula you need to learn here is if there's a receipt, I'm going to create a foreign currency loan. If there's a payment that I am, you know, having due in, say, 3 or 6 months time, I'm going to create a foreign currency investment. So the whole purpose of creating this hedge artificially is to be able to negate the profit and loss of one transaction with the other, right? Any doubt, anything anybody would like to ask here? Derivatives, okay with everyone? Okay, quickly revise this as well. Purchasing power parity. Okay, sorry, just give me a second. There was a long message which I think missed. Face confusion sometime when we have to use deposit rate or when we have to use borrowing rate in calculating today's amount in foreign currency. Please clear what logic is to be used. We just cleared that, Jatin. So what we are doing, in case we have a receivable, I'm going to create a foreign currency loan. So what do you mean by a foreign currency loan? I'm going to be creating a loan for myself in foreign currency. So I'm going to be making use of the, what will you do? You'll be depositing in the local currency and you'll be borrowing in the, how do you create a loan, right? You borrow in the foreign currency, right? And similarly, if you have a payment, you're creating an investment for yourself, a foreign currency investment. You will be earning interest on foreign currency investment. So you've deposited in the foreign currency and you will be borrowing in the local currency. So this, I think, just if you remember just this part, all the confusion would be clear. Right, Jatin? Great. Can you explain the purchasing power parity and the yield curve movement? So we've already done that. Purchasing power parity simply talks about the fact that what is the difference in the inflation rate of one economy to the other. So if I am based in the US, my local currency is the dollar. I have a payable or a receivable in dinars. How is my local currency? You know, what is the inflation rate here in the US versus the inflation rate in UAE? So this is how you will be comparing the inflation rates. Always your home currency will come as denominator. Remember the formula and just follow your purchasing power parity, right? Yield curve movements simply show that how your interest rate is linked to the payout, to the cost of interest that you're paying. So that if it's a normal yield curve, the higher the duration, the low, you know, the higher the amount of interest rate that is going to be there. If it is a negative yield curve, it simply means that you are going to be having a higher cost of capital for short-term investments instead, right? When we create the foreign currency loan, which spot rate do we use to convert in domestic currency? So what are you doing? You're buying your domestic currency, right? You are buying domestic currency means bank is selling domestic currency, right? So you take the sell rate of the bank, right, Anshu? Just always keep your logic very, very clear that if this is what I'm doing, this is what the bank is doing. And if this is what the bank is doing, I'm going to use the requisite rate from the bank's perspective. Right, Anshu? Wonderful. Any other doubt? Anything anybody would like to ask here? We use spot rate on the basis of bank perspective. Yes, always from the bank's perspective. Always remember, you as a customer are always going to be worse off. The bank is always going to buy at a lesser rate and sell to you at a higher rate. That is also one perspective that you can learn, that the bank always is better off. Bank buys at lesser rates and sells at higher rate. Right, Anshu? Okay, so quickly let's proceed. Have a look at this, please. Okay, I've run out of water also now. Okay, everybody okay with it? Any doubts? Let's move on to the last leg of it, the interest rate risk then. Done it? Any query? Quickly revise it, please. Any queries? Anything anybody would like to ask here? Quickly go through the derivatives and the yield curve. Any questions on this part? Okay, wonderful. So I see you're all well prepared towards your exam, and it gives me immense, you know, happiness to see that we are literally finished off with the entire financial management syllabus. We've done lots and lots of question practice. We've revised the entire curriculum as well. We've gone through an entire CBE mock exam as well. So we've literally, like, you know, I've tried to give my 100% here. now the ball is in your court, because this is the last session of our financial management syllabus. From now, it is only going to be you revising and giving your 100% towards your exam. Remember, at the end of the day, it is you who has to give your exam. So please be honest to yourself. Do mock exams. Do at least 3 mock exams. Send one across to me for me to check. Self-mark at least 2 mock exams yourself. Sit for mock exams under a timed environment. Extremely important. Make sure you're revising each and every question from your practice and revision kit. Very important to go through the theoretical concepts, because financial management paper is not going to be just only numbers. It is going to ask you theory questions out and out directly as well. So very important that aspect as well. Thereafter, we had a look at some of the extremely important resources available for us as students on the ACCA's website. So open up accaglobal.com, go under the student section, study support resources, choose your qualification, choose your paper. All of these are absolutely very, very important resources available from ACCA for you to review. No, Jatin, this is the last class of financial management. We've literally done everything that was required. And now I'm going to share a few resources on your WhatsApp group and available to you for any of your queries. But yes, theoretically, concept-wise, we've literally done the entire syllabus. And now the next few days that you have before your exam is entirely, you know, the ball is in your court now, right? So effective learning and revision, technical articles, examiner's report. Again, I'm showing all of this to you that you must do this. So go through this question practice. Again, it says to go through the practice platform. Look at the exam technique, do mock exams. So literally everything which I have been, you know, telling to you is already mentioned here. So go through these technical articles. Go through examiner's report. Very, very important for you to get and understand that what is it that the examiner was looking for. So I'll give you a very simple way of doing this. So what you do, you pick on any of these questions yourself. So do, supposingly you're doing September, December 2020 exam yourself. Submit the entire question yourself. Submit the entire exam yourself. Do it yourself months. Then after having done a self-review for it, download this examiner's report and just study it from the examiner's perspective. That what did the examiner find good? What did the examiner give marks for? And what were the areas which students made mistake? Did I do the same mistake? Did I do the, you know, or did I just follow the correct approach? This will help you streamline your approach to the maximum potential which is actually required. So extremely important. Please at least go through 2 examiner's reports, if not more, right? So the exams that you sit for, go through the examiner's debrief for it, right? Everybody okay with it? I hope you're all able to understand that what is it that you are now required to do in the next few days. Technical articles, again, very important tools. These are topics written by the examiner, even though they would not be, you know, tested like directly. There would definitely be something that you should be familiar with. Where did my technical articles go? Just 1 second. Here you are, the technical articles. So just go through these, please. These are again same topics as we've already done in our, in our classes, but these are just articles written by the examiner. So why not understand the language, the way, the concepts which the examiner is like stressing more upon. So if I tell you inflation and investment appraisal, so this is the examiner's take on it. So just review it like a revision, review it like, you know, that you are able to revise all the concept that we've already done from the examiner's perspective. So this will really, really, you know, add a lot of value to your writing, to your skills that you are understanding that, okay, this is how I really need to be talking about it, right? So few articles here, just review them once, please. I think I had already mentioned in one of my first classes itself that which are these technical articles which are extremely important. There you are. So this is your first PPT. At least, if not all, at least go through these three technical articles written by the examiner, right? So that's it really, guys, from my end. I am here now, gonna wind up your financial management, the entire classes. If you have any doubts, please feel free to always reach out to me. I'm available on WhatsApp. My email ID is also mentioned on the screen. And that's it, guys. Thank you so much for these sessions and all the very best for your exam. Please give it your 100%, be 100% sincere in your efforts. And believe you me, I'm sure 50 is a very, very attainable number. Just do as what I have advised you in the classes, and I'm sure that you're all going to pass. Thank you so much then, and very good luck to all of you. Thank you. Bye-bye.